quantum technology can do incredible things. We can use quantum sensors to detect even the smallest magnetic fields. We can send totally secure messages across long distances. And we'll be able to solve problems with quantum computers that even the most powerful regular computers can't solve. But none of this would be possible without the fuel that makes quantum technology work, quantum entanglement. We're your hosts. I'm Robby Weinbaum.
And I'm Katie Sauter. Today, we're going to talk about how we can connect quantum systems with the power of entanglement.
We've previously talked about the quantum property of superposition, where a quantum system is in a combination of its possible states. Like superposition, entanglement is something totally unique to quantum mechanics. It doesn't have any analog in our everyday experiences, but it is how everything interacts at the quantum level. It's how we make a lot of quantum technology actually happen. Systems that are entangled are connected, but not by something physical like a wire or a string. It's more like a relationship. When two quantum systems become entangled, they essentially become one combined quantum system in superposition. That means we can't independently describe the properties of each system on its own anymore. When we measure a property of one of the two systems, it's the same as measuring that property in both systems.
Take spin, for example, a property unique to quantum particles. When you measure a particle's spin, you only get two possible answers, up or down. Like we talked about previously, a single particle can also be in a superposition of these two outcomes, up or down. But a quantum system made of two entangled particles can actually be in a superposition of four outcomes. Two where they're in the same direction, and two where they're in opposite directions.
Measuring a quantum system in superposition forces it to settle into one of its possible outcomes. Because these two entangled particles are now one quantum system, measuring the spin of just one of the particles is equivalent to measuring the spins in the entire system. Now, both particles are forced to settle on an outcome, even though only one particle is measured. It's like we get two measurements for the price of one.
Let's consider a specific example to make the strangeness of quantum entanglement a little bit clearer. Here, we have a pair of shoes. But these shoes aren't just an ordinary pair of shoes. They're a set of quantum shoes. If I put the left shoe in one box and keep the right in the other box, and then we mix them up in a quantum way, what we have now is an entangled system.
But what exactly does that mean? Well, suppose that I take one of the shoe boxes and Katie takes the other. Because we mixed up the boxes in some particular quantum way, the shoe in my quantum shoe box is now in a superposition of being a right shoe and a left shoe.
And the same goes for the shoe in my quantum shoebox. It's also in a superposition of right and left. It's only when I open my shoebox that the shoe collapses into one of its two possibilities.
But when we say that our shoes are entangled, we mean that once Katie goes ahead and looks at what shoe she has in her shoebox, she immediately knows that I have the other shoe. So my shoe is no longer in a superposition, even if I didn't open the box.
This can happen instantaneously, even from very far away. Say I take my shoebox to the North Pole, and Robby takes his to the South Pole. The moment I look in my shoebox and see that I have the right shoe, I immediately know that Robby's shoe will collapse into being a left shoe.
This is how quantum particles can be used to communicate. You entangle them together at the start, and then send one of them to whoever's receiving your signal. Their measurements are then dependent on each other, which can be useful for communication.
You might ask, how is this different than if we split up an ordinary pair of shoes and shoe boxes? Well, ordinary shoes always have a definite state. A shoe is either always left or it's always right. With ordinary shoes, when we split up, I would have had the same right shoe from the beginning. The outcome was decided before we separated, even if we didn't know it. That's not what happens with entangled quantum systems.
Instead, the state of each shoe, left or right, is only decided once its superposition is broken through measurement. The shoe that I'm holding is neither the right nor the left until I, or Katie, open our box and look. This is something unique that can only happen at the quantum level.
Entanglement happens naturally in nature, but we can also control it in a lab. Instead of using pairs of shoes, we can entangle the spins of two particles such that the relationship between the spins, whether they point in the same direction or opposite directions, has to stay the same even after we put them in superposition and then measure them.
So if we know which relationship the spins have before we entangle them, when we measure the spin of one particle, we automatically know what the spin of the other particle is. Entanglement happens whenever quantum systems interact. And it's this entanglement, this interaction, that enables quantum technology to do such incredible things. Qubits are entangled together in different sequences to make quantum computers do calculations. Entanglement is also how we can securely communicate quantum information over long distances. And entanglement is how quantum sensors are sensitive enough to detect even single particles.
So we've spent several episodes talking about the basic principles of quantum mechanics.
Next time, we'll talk to other quantum scientists about how quickly quantum science and engineering is growing, and how it's already changing the world.
Until next time, you can check out our page for more content. You can also find transcripts for our episodes linked below.